Hello, I'm Chris Flisher, and welcome to Turning of the Wheel, an intelligent, lively discussion on astrology, art, and adventure. Timing is everything, and as the great wheel turns, we are best prepared when we are best informed. Join me as I explore the current planetary alignments and offer insights for coping with change. Educational, informative, enlightening, the turning of the wheel is a welcome pause in your daily swirl of constant change. Through intelligent discourse, inspired guests, and educational segments, I will help to enlighten your knowledge of astrology and guide you to accept change as the great wheel of life turns. Call in with your questions and speak with some of the greatest visionaries in the time-tested practice of astrology. Turning of the Wheel, Astrology, Art, and Adventure with Chris Flisher, each week on Turning of the Wheel podcast. Hello and welcome to Turning the Wheel. My name is Chris Flisher, and this is a show about astrology. More than anything else, I do often delve into other topics occasionally. I love all those weird, esoteric sort of topics, but my primary goal has always been to focus on astrology because I'm an astrologer. And that's what the whole basis of the Turning of the Wheel has always been about. The basis of it has been astrology. But I like the idea that I branch off a little bit other areas too, because it gives me a chance to delve into other areas and broaden the conversation a little bit more. Got a great guest coming on in a few minutes here. Before we get started, I want to remind you about my newsletter, which goes out every Sunday afternoon. In there, you'll find a couple of paragraphs of mundane astrology as it applies to all of us, and then I break it out in the individual signs beneath that. I also include links to my podcast. I include links to my television series, my educational television series, and interviews as well, also called turningofthewheel.tv, and anything else that has to do with me as well as my artwork, which is on there as well. So if you want to do that, that is a good way of getting keeping in touch with me and knowing where all the podcasts are and knowing what's going on in the world. So without further ado, let's get my guest on. Her name is Louise Edington, and she's an astrologer out of Utah, and her website is louiseedington.com. That's LouiseEdington.com, louiseedington.com. And she has just released a new book called The Complete Guide to Astrology, and we're going to be talking about that a little bit. And then, as astrologers are prone to do, we may meander a little bit around the world there, but that's okay. We'll do it anyway. So, Louise, welcome to the show today. It's great to have you on.
Hi, Chris. Thank you for having me on.
Yeah, it's great. I love your website, Astrology for Kick-Ass Women. That really sends a message out there.
Oh, yeah.
you're not limited to just women, though, I assume, right?
No, but I generally don't work with men that much. I think a lot of men find me a bit intimidating.
Oh, wow. That's good. I'm glad you warned me. I think it's more than – I think women, as a rule, tend to be more interested in astrology than men. I think that's – if you looked at any of the conferences or anything you go to, it's almost generally, you know, 80% women and maybe 20% or 30% men. So I think there's more of a leaning of women are more inclined towards it, perhaps. I'm not sure if I'm making an assumption or making a generalization, but it seems that way to me.
It does to me too. But, you know, it's I kind of joke about men finding me intimidating. Some of my best friends are actually men. I try to encourage women to
take charge.
Kick ass.
Yeah, and it's about time. I think your time has come. Women, as a gender, your time is waiting, desperately waiting to turn over the leaf here and get rid of this palaver we have going on now and get on to something a little bit more feminine. I think it's time for the feminine divine to step in and take over. So I'm right with you on that one.
Yeah.
Let's talk about your book. You just finished this book called The Complete Guide to Astrology, right?
Yes.
And what can you tell me about it that perhaps it may be a little bit different than other books about astrology that we've seen? Or is this more of a contemporary version? Or is this all viewed through the lens of the kick-ass woman?
Uh-huh. Well, I published this under a publishing company called Callisto Press. And they work in a very unusual way. They actually find somebody to write a book to what people are looking for. Okay. Uh-huh. And they identified a need for a new basic astrology book, if you like,
okay.
That was a little bit different to the previous ones before, more contemporary, and one that spoke to a more inclusive message. Because, you know, the old astrology books are very much, well, Mars is masculine, Venus is feminine.
Right.
Very polarized, very binary. Mm-hmm. And it's not a political book, so I don't mean to speak of it in that way. They just They just wanted somebody to look at it from a more diffuse lens and one that would speak to everybody, no matter what their gender identification.
Right, so. Right. Well, you know, I think it's worthwhile to contemporize that because we are contemporary people living in a contemporary world. We might as well use a contemporary text in order to address that. So that sort of makes sense to me because, you know, a lot of the old astrology books that I have, and I'm sure you have thousands of them as well as I do, there's a certain repetitiveness to them. I mean, they have different styles, but there is a certain repetitiveness to them that, you know, sort of the cookbook approach, you know, if you got this, you've got that, if you got this, you got that. And those things are all fine and good, but I think it's good to bring it into the world of a contemporary view. I think it does help in that regard.
And I think we have to remember that they were written under a very patriarchal world
too. Yes, a lot of them were, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So it's nothing wrong with them. The mm-hmm. astrology is still good. It's just the language.
Right. And that's a very important distinction because you have to be able to get to people. And because we're living in a contemporary world using contemporary tools. You know, the astrology that you studied when you were younger and I studied when I was younger is much different than the astrology. We never had the tools when I was starting first study. We never had just the simple fact of the computer. Just being that alone, being involved is a huge step in a different direction. So.
Exactly.
Things have changed dramatically. And it's nice to get a fresh view. And I think every one of us, you know, I had this conversation many times with astrologers. The idea that, you know, you can never know it all. You can never know everything about astrology. I think that's a fair statement. But you can know an awful lot and you can often have specialties in certain areas. And I think that everyone's voice is unique in their interpretation of what we can understand. And I think the voice of the author in particular speaks to the person who reads that, that they can understand that language and that vernacular that they're speaking with, and it makes sense that that would be a contemporary approach, and it's worthwhile to have a refresh of it all, so to speak, you know, a refresh of the information.
For sure, yeah. And, you know, we have to remember that the word astrology itself means language of the stars, so yeah. Our language mm-hmm. is shaping how we perceive what the message of the stars means.
Exactly. And I think that's open to interpretation, you know, I mean, everybody, you know, depending upon the individual who's writing their birth chart, there's going to have a different approach to how they, you know, sort of frame their descriptions of the certain aspects and stuff like that. You know, I've always thought of astrology being a collection of stories. And when I'm doing a reading for somebody, I will throw out a bunch of stories that I see that are sort of tied to the chart. Now, they may not be specific to the person I'm speaking with because I don't really know that much about the person other than their astrology chart. But I'll say, here's a story that you might be able to tease out an idea or an aspect or a message from. Mm-hmm. The story may not be, yeah, it may not be your story, but you can get the emphasis of what I'm trying to say. The germ of the theme is there.
Mm-hmm. I do exactly the same when I work with clients, yeah. Plus, I'm also a shamanic practitioner, so I come very much from this diffuse, more magical world, if you like, mm-hmm. that doesn't see things in very black and white polarized terms, mm-hmm. You know. Do you know Jason Holly?
I do. I've not had him on the show yet, but I do know who he is, yeah.
Well, you know, I was coming to write this book, beginning to write it, trying to get my voice in this book, and I happened just to see a post. I've never met him. I've never seen him speak. But this post just talked about the astrology of sect, the terms day and night, and using a more diffuse approach. And he comes upon it from a psychologizing astrology approach. And I come upon it more from a language of astrology approach, but they kind of intersect anyway.
They do. I think. There's other Mark Jones. I think is also a psychological, and Liz Green, of course, is known for her psychological approach to astrology. I think they're closely connected. As a matter of fact, I did a reading the other day for somebody, and she wanted some information about her son, and she's been spending hundreds of dollars on a therapist for her son, and I was able to get to the root of the cause of the problem in an hour because she is spending all this money going to the therapist. Whereas if people would have more faith and trust in astrology, they could see that you can get this information much faster and in a much clearer way just by doing that alone and not having to depend upon sitting there with somebody taking notes and shaking their head for days on days and end, you know?
I agree. I always said it's a fast track.
It gets you the core very quickly. Just knowing you know how fast you are if you're out and about and you run into somebody and you tell them you're an astrologer and you say, well, if you know your birthday, you can get your sun, your rising sign, your moon very quickly. Just those three small data points, and they're not small by any means, but they can give you a great deal of information about a person very quickly.
Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah, I like that approach. And, you know, I think the, you know, the, I, you know, and I do in some ways, I know what you're saying about it being black and white, and there is something about that that does rub me the wrong way because I don't like that sort of finite edges to it. But there is, astrology is a dualistic study. I mean, we are comprised of dualism. I mean, we have these, for every sign, there's an opposing sign, and we have these, there's this back and forth. It's sort of like the nature of the positive and the negative of life. I think that's very true in some ways, don't you? I mean, you probably may take offense to a difference to that.
No, I do agree, but I also think the key to integrating those opposites is the meeting in the middle.
Right. I like to use color when I talk about the things because I think that when I look at a sign, for example, if I look at, say, Aries, 15 degrees Aries, I would say, well, that is really, really red. Okay? That's as red as you can get. And yet, then you go towards the 29 to 28, 29, it's going to get a little bit different color. You go to the 0 and the 1s or the 2 degrees of Aries, it's going to be, it's sort of like a pastel of a gradient.
Exactly, and I don't think we can ever ignore that opposite point as well, which of course is 15 Libra, which is has got a very different color again.
Exactly. That's and they should be by theory, and they actually are complementary, which is what you want. They want to be because I've always thought of the opposite sign as the person bringing something to the other sign that they need but can't get on their own. So you always have that sort of complementary, symbiotic relationship between two people, and one brings to the conversation what the other may not have sometimes. Some of my most, long-term clients have been in marriages or relationships for a very long time with the opposite signs, and we're very happy with them oftentimes.
And regarding the kind of polarity, duality kind of thing, there's also the emphasis that the answer is in the what I've always called the empty leg, due to one
Yes.
which is the way. So that is the opposite. So if you're looking to say if you do have Mars in Aries at 15 degrees and you're trying to, temper that a bit to in through personal growth, the answer is in the Libra,
Yeah,
really.
that's exactly right. Exactly, and that's the beauty of it all. That's why it's such a fascinating discovery and a wonderful language to understand. It really is a language. There's no question about it because we have terms and definitions and sort of containers of definitions that allow us to flesh out the language and sort of knead up that sort of personality trait that we look for when we do a chart. And I think that comes from sort of a I do at least I do a free form sort of I don't want to. Thought process of just, I sort of intuit the process of what's going on in the chart. I'm sure you're the same way. There's a lot of intuition that goes into reading a chart. When we get that, it feels very real, and you can see the stories just jump out at you, and it's just incredible in that regard.
Oh, absolutely. I never go into a reading now trying to just do a by rote natal reading and covering every point in the chart. I read the story as a whole,
Right, it's
and
more of a composite, and a sort of a collaboration of a bunch of stories that make into one. And that's very indicative of how we are as human beings. We all have personality traits. We have assets and liabilities. We want to play up our assets and try to mitigate our liabilities. That's presumably the right way to go, I think.
exactly. And it's also dependent on what's happening now in the cosmos in relation to the natal charts. So
Exactly. Yeah. It's been fascinating for me. I'm the father of twins, and they were born 6 minutes apart. So they have a different ascendant by 2 degrees because one was born at, just the edge of the 1 degree and the other one. So they have 2 degree difference on in their charts. And I love it because I have this built-in laboratory in some ways. I don't really let on to it too much to them because they don't like to hear it, but it really is a laboratory because I can see the way they respond. I can see their interests, and yet their experiences are different. And so the character and the personality of their experiences has been colored by what they've lived through. Now they don't live and walk and talk exactly the same, but there are similarities there. But what changes them is their experience, like you say, what's going on in the current world today, and how does that impacting one child versus the other child?
yeah, twins are fascinating.
Oh, I
I'm
tell you,
almost jealous.
Well, I don't know if you want to be jealous. There's a lot of work too. I'm an Aries, and my twins were born early, and so they were supposed to be Geminis, coincidentally, and they ended up being Tauruses, and they are Tauruses if ever there were Tauruses. So you can imagine a fast-moving Aries with a couple of slow-moving Tauruses, and things have been moving very slowly with regard to progress.
Oh, I can imagine.
Yeah, but it's been fun. I tease them all the time, and they know who I am, and I love them dearly. But it has been fun to watch. and some study. So let's talk a little bit more about your book. What can you tell us about it that you think really, you said you had to find your voice, and that's not an easy thing to do, because I'm a writer as well. I spend a lot of time doing creative writing and other kinds of writing. And I know that it's, you know, finding your voice is something you've got to wrestle with, but I also think that the finding the voice is directly tied to the subject of what you're talking about. And if you're writing poetry, your voice is going to be different. If you're writing an article for the local newspaper, and if you're writing a book about astrology, your voice has to be sort of wrapped into that astrology head. Now, if you're like me, you live, eat, and breathe and drink astrology all day long, so it sort of naturally just comes out of your system in the way you have interpreted it. But how would you describe your process and going about the whole idea of how you found your voice for the book?
I had to feel into it, and I wrote almost a complete first draft before I finally found my voice. And
Interesting.
I work a lot with memberships. I have a membership site as well as doing just client readings, and I bring my shamanic work more into the membership. And I very much see the universe working within us as a living, breathing, pulsing energy. And I had to find a way to bring that into the book. I did not want it just to be a book from my head.
Right. So do you have sidebars that deal with the shamanic approach, or asides that sort of delve into the approach, or you just filter everything through a shamanic sort of lens?
Trying to, it's been a while since I wrote it. Everything was filtered through the shamanic lens, really, and kind of the introduction and the conclusion speak more to that. All the way through, I've not only described the planets as and signs and aspects, everything, as day and night energy, so that we can see the day and night revolving throughout the chart, through all the energies. I also speak of it as an inhale and exhale
That's
going around the chart.
a good way of looking at it. Yeah, I like that, because that's certainly, there again is an example of the dualistic nature of our lives, the in and the out. It's always there, the dark and the light, the positive and negative.
But then there's the twilight too, you know. For
Right,
example,
where the shades get a little bit different, right, and the colors become a little bit different. I understand that as well. Yeah, interesting. Did you find yourself sort of having to do research on the book, as far as sort of what did other authors say about an aspect, or what did other author, how did other authors describe, or did you try to just remove yourself from the outside influence and just sort of drill in on your own voice and stuff?
I try to remove myself from the description of the individual signs, planets, and aspects, etc. But I did research the astrology of sect more to inform it, because that seemed to be really relevant. And I've long talked on podcasts and with my clients and everybody about the age of Aquarius, which we're clearly moving into. Who knows when we'll be in it? But as having the dual rulership of Saturn and Uranus, and being this real mix of the ancient and the modern.
Right.
And it just came to me that we could integrate this astrology of sect in a very modern way, you know, rather than following their rigid rules also, which was also a very patriarchal time.
Yeah, right. And there's something about the there's a softer approach that can be taken. I mean, it's all about the language. There's no question about it. And your voice is critical, because you want to be able to express that voice in ways that are different. And I've had this conversation myself with myself, I guess I should say, about how do I feel differently about the way I've read things from my past and my studies about how someone might have described a certain piece of astrology, and how I might view it differently and make it more, I don't know. I think contemporary is the right word. I hate to keep using it, but we live in a different, time is always moving. It's a continuum. It's like a giant corkscrew. Around and around we go, but it keeps going down the road further. And in that time, where nothing can ever be the same. So the themes that were relevant to 30, 40, 50 years ago are not going to be the same when you're talking about, I mean, we never would have even used the word text message, 40 years ago. We didn't even know what it was. Now it's part of our common vernacular. Now we can integrate social media into the idea of astrology and language, just because if it's another vehicle, it's another methodology for us to use as a tool to help describe where we are now, which makes it easier for younger people to understand what astrology is really about.
I also did have to research quantum entanglement and wave theory a little bit, which is kind of deep for me.
Yeah, I can imagine. I can imagine.
I'm not a scientist, but it right. made sense to me, you know, that we are, that's what we're moving into this. We're the world where we realize everything is connected. And, mm-hmm. you know, if I breathe in here in Utah, it affects something somewhere else in the world.
Yes, I agree with that too. And, you know, and for any time someone dies on the planet, we all feel it in some capacity. You know, I think it's all part of, because we're all part of this gigantic stew, or soup, or whatever you want to call it. And it's cosmic soup. And we all, when anybody dies on the planet, we somehow, in some visceral planetary, you know, core level, we do feel it, I think. I think there's a certain amount of that. I mean, I think that's fairly accurate to say. You know, the idea of, I love the idea of the quantum entanglements, because it's really, I mean, I think as time goes on, we're going to learn more and more about how relevant this really is, because this, the whole thread of DNA and the sort of that corkscrew that I mentioned, because we really are, I think of astrology as just like a giant corkscrew. You know, we're going around and around that corkscrew, but every time we're going down the road a little bit further. So the scene, the players, the setting, the circumstances are all different and unique. And no matter where you put the needle down on that record, so to speak, it's going to be different. And it's going to change as time goes on. And so that, just that alone, means that the astrology is always changing and it's always going to be different. And the language we use to apply to that is where the real challenge is. And of course, you probably understand that better than anybody for having just written this book. The challenge is how to make that relevant to a society today and into an audience of today.
And, you know, it's kind of funny, really, looking at the reviews so far. There's a Virgo editor who did not get it at all. You know,
really interesting. Huh.
It was not black and white enough, and uh-huh. it was too woolly for her. She said, "Well, you know, I think life is woolly in many ways. So.
It's very woolly, and I think that, you know, that's a certain that I could almost see a Virgo wanting things a little more precise than that. I mean, that I can see that, but there." You know, it's in the description, it's in the interpretation, it's in the nuance is the word I want. Nuance.
Yeah.
It's a very nuanced language, and you have to be able to tap into the nuance of the time and the theme, because that can change. That's why I have such fascinating time talking with astrologers, because when you get onto the nuance and you begin to, you can get different shades of things, you know. And I hear people on Facebook and I say, well, I never thought of it that way. And it's just nice to have that exchange. Even when people say that a planet's in its, you know, in its detriment, I say, well, you know, there's something that can come from that. You know, there's
I don't use those words anymore.
Yeah, I tend not to either, but it is there. You know, maybe I'd use a more contemporary word. I'd say it's not very well placed or whatever. It's not happy there or whatever, but that doesn't mean that Mars can't still have an impact no matter where it is.
Yeah. I like Jason Holly's word diffuse, taking a little bit diffuse view, and a shamanic term for it is second attention.
Second attention, huh?
Yeah, it's like you look at something first, and it looks like the outline that we try and shape it, and then you kind of look at it with this second sideways glance, and it kind of changes shape a little bit.
So, right. Like that. I always think of it like, I always use the example of a prism. I say, if you look through a prism and you're looking through a, you know, a beam of sun coming into your house or whatever, if you look through the prism, you're going to see a certain set of colors or whatever. Then you just tip that 1 degree in the other direction and boom, things change. Or it's kind of like a kaleidoscope in that regard, I suppose. But I think I like the idea of a prism better, because prism does have the mechanical and mathematical qualities of frequency that seems to resonate with the planets as well. So that's why I always fall back to the prism. But it feels like that to me, where we get that sort of look. And it's just a question of turning that. And then you get that different view, like you said, that second view.
Yeah. Yeah, prism's a great one, actually. I wish I'd put that in my book.
Well, it's next edition. So have you found the book well-received in that regard, with regard to younger people? Or do you find that people are, you know, because there's a lot of, you go to an astrology bookstore, there's probably 15, 20, maybe more, you know, guide to astrology books out there.
I've found it really well received. And yes, particularly amongst younger people.
Right.
Generally. But also, the people who endorsed it, Jason was one of them. Patricia Walsh was another one. Uh-huh. You know, they're all working more in the psychological shamanic realms. And they just get it. And they're going to be using it for all their students, they've said. recommending it. So I'm very honored by that.
That's good. Now, when you talk about the shamanic piece, we can get into this further on in the show, but what you know, can you clarify a little more about that, what that looks like, so people really understand?
Yeah, I mean, shamanism really is just being in alignment with the natural cycles of the world and working in alignment and tapping into that kind of more non-ordinary reality mm-hmm. as well. So it's got that diffuse second attention kind of feel to it again. I do shamanic journey work, particularly with my clients. And I also do a couple of other shamanic healing techniques. And it is really about going into that world that's a bit underneath the shadowy kind of world mm-hmm. that we don't see in the daylight, which actually blocks out the stars, if you think. So that's right. Why it's the day and night. So it's getting into that night feel of it. Mm-hmm.
And how do you peel away the layers to get to that?
With my clients,
or with yourself? Or, yeah, just how do you get to that spot? Do you have to use some sort of stimulation? Do you have to get into a mindset? Do you have to meditate in order to draw that sort of theme up so that it speaks to you?
Okay, well, shamanic journey work is usually done to drumming,
right?
Which is the heartbeat of the earth. So it kind of takes you into another state of consciousness. And it really is just letting your imagination flow and journeying to non-ordinary reality is all I can describe it as. So it's letting your imagination flow and trusting what you get and moving into other realms in your imagination. You don't have to believe they really exist, but mm-hmm. maybe they do. You
know, you're tapping into your intuition and you're sort of pulling on this, you can feel this sort of gut sort of pull, right, that you're drawing on here. There's an impression you're feeling.
And you asked how I found my voice for the book. I did it, a lot of it, through journey work. I journey to the planets myself. I journey to find answers about the signs. I have my clients doing that. I get them to journey to the planets so that I'm not just telling them words, so that they can actually feel the energy of the planets. Mm-hmm. And it's just in their intuition and imagination. You know, they're obviously not really traveling to Mars or whatever.
Oh, no, I know. But you've got to be able to reach a point in your mind where you have the freedom and with unbounded sort of ability to open up to the place to a point where you can allow that to happen. That requires a certain type of person and a certain type of a view of the world. You have to have a certain sort of, you're working with a different set of tools, right? I mean,
yeah, for sure. But I think anybody can do it if they choose to. Mm-hmm. You know, you just have to be able to relax and let the drumbeat take you away and trust that your imagination is giving you some kind of answer you need.
Yeah, the drumbeat sort of is representative of the heartbeat and sort of the heartbeat of the planet and the sort of the underlying, you know, rhythms that sort of propel us through, because we are in a world that is filled with rhythms and sort of this frequencies of ideas, and they've got to be able to percolate up through a person.
Yeah.
And it's difficult. I mean, not everybody can get there, but a large part of it, if you can't get there, maybe you don't need to get there. People who want to get there can get there because they've got the ability to do that.
Yeah. You know? So I don't do meditation as such in the traditional form, the Buddhist form of emptying your mind. Mm-hmm. I'm more, let's use my active imagination to get my answers.
Yeah. So. And they come up through your imagination as sort of, they just come sort of like flashing through. They sort of just boom, they pop into your, yeah.
Yeah, they do. And
like Uranian epiphanies.
Yeah, really. You know, I'll journey to Mars and maybe, for example, or Chiron's one of my favorite to journey to. And I ask questions, you know, and Chiron answers me.
Yeah, Chiron is an interesting planet. It really, it speaks to, and when you find it in the natal chart, it really answers a lot of questions. I'll tell you that much. It certainly... It can really say, wow, no wonder I had this when you know, so-and-so, whatever, when I was younger. It really all clicks together when you find that. We're speaking today with Louise Edington. She is the author of The Complete Guide to Astrology, which has just been released, which you can find up on all the usual places that you go to. Hopefully you can go to a brick-and-mortar bookstore, help somebody out and buy it there. But if not, you know where you find it. The Complete Guide to Astrology. Her website is Louise Edington. It's L-O-U-I-S-E. edington.com, LouiseEdington.com. And it is a great website. It's a astrology for kick-ass women. And so I encourage you to check it out. We'll take a quick break here, and we'll be back in about 2.5 minutes. In the meantime, LouiseEddington.com is your place to go, and her book is The Complete Guide to Astrology. So hang in there. We'll be right back.
What is your destiny? Where are you going? What is your real purpose? Do you know? Do you want to know? Of course you do. It's your duty to yourself. We are all here for a reason, and we all have great potential. Discover all of this and more with a professional astrology reading. My name is Chris Flisher, and I can help you. Discover your strengths and work on your weaknesses, and live your life to its fullest capacity. Based on your birthday, birthplace, and birth time, an authentic astrology reading will allow you to live your life to the fullest and reveal your true purpose. Only real astrology can give you real information. It is your destiny, and it is your path. Write me at chris@chrisflisher.com and book a reading today. Or call me at 978-393-1036. That's 978-393-1036. www.chrisflisher.com.
Astrology is the science of spirit, and it can serve as an invaluable aid in making the difficult choices in life and seeking truth in all the directions we choose. It holds the potential to allow each of us to evolve to our highest potential. It is the logic of the universe, the code of existence, and the pathway to true wisdom. It is our duty to draw from it the instructions for our lives and to live them to our fullest potential. As the great wheel turns, we are best prepared when we are best informed.
As the world shrinks and our barriers come down, diverse cultures are striving for harmony, balance, and peace. To ease the transition, we need to expand with color, light, and tolerance. Now, you can become a global citizen and embrace the color and clear spirit with the divine artwork of the mandala. Mandalas are a timeless artistic offering for creating unity, harmony, and peace. My name is Chris Flisher, and I've spent years creating mandalas, and they are now available online at www.turningofthewheel.com. Come and experience the world of color, form, and function with t-shirts, coffee mugs, note cards, and limited edition prints. These vibrant, lively paintings and products express optimism, oneness, and spiritual balance for all who use them. www.turningofthewheel.com. That's www.turningofthewheel.com. And enter a world of possibility and color.
Okay, welcome back to the Turning of the Wheel. My name is Chris Flisher, as you know. My guest today is Louise Edington. Her website is louiseeddington.com. It's an astrology for kick-ass women, but men can go there too. Don't be afraid. Nothing to be fearful here. Louise is a sweet person. LouiseEddington.com, and she's just completed the book, The Complete Guide to Astrology, which is a more... Now, there's lots of books on astrology. Those of you listening to this show, you'll know there's thousands of books on astrology, and thank God there are. But hers is a more contemporary, perhaps more a different set of view. I think it's important that people do that. I think it's very important to have different views of astrology because there's so many ways to interpret. And interpretation is really an art of, taking the science and translating in the art of it and turning it, putting the whole thing together into some sort of a cohesive package that makes sense for you. And you've got to be able to find that. And there's a lot of story threads that run through all of our charts and are deeply embedded in our personalities. And they're there for the taking and they're there for the discovery. If you find the right vehicle in, and I think Louise's book might be a very good way to start. But we were talking some of the things we talked about when you talked about the wave. You had mentioned this earlier, Louise, the quantum wave you were talking about, or quantum entanglement, and other things you mentioned there.
Well, I mentioned the age of Aquarius. Too.
Right, that's right. Okay, yeah, there we go.
Yeah, and my research. Into wave theory and quantum wave theory and quantum entanglement theory. Mm-hmm. And I suddenly had this like very Aquarian, Uranian kind of hit around the head. And I was like, oh, there's that glyph. You know, the Aquarius glyph is the wave, the two
waves. Yeah.
And I was like, we are moving into this age of Aquarius, which is wave theory or the entanglement theory. We that's it.
It certainly makes sense. You think about it, because the waves are a symbol of frequency as well as water and as well as inclusion and sort of, you know, sort of this frequency we feel. And I think we're really entering into that age because you look at what Facebook does, you look at what cell phone technology does. We are into a world where we communicate far differently than we ever had before, in a much broader spectrum than we ever had before.
I agree. And, you know, we hear a lot of people theorizing that telepathy is going to be on the rise, and just people understanding each other. And my own work with my own clients does show me that awareness, at least, of psychic abilities is becoming more common.
Oh, I believe that for sure, yeah.
Yeah, and all of that's part of this wave theory.
Well, it makes sense if you think about our evolution. We're evolving to a new way of communicating. We're evolving to a new level of understanding. We're going to get deeper into the world of frequency, deeper into the world of sort of this, like this ESP, like you say, this psychic learning, this sort of intuitive connection, which is really going to change the way we communicate and the way we interact. But I think it's all for the good if we can get there. I think the age of Aquarius is a time, I believe it's on the horizon as well. I think that Saturn, Jupiter, and eventually Pluto getting into Aquarius will really pop open that door into the extent, I mean, it's a slow, long, gradual march, just like history is. But I do believe that once we get there, we'll see, wow, that we are really, we'll reach a new point of collective responsibility. I think that Saturn there represents collective responsibility. And I think then Jupiter comes along and sort of amplifies that whole conversation and starts the conversation saying, what do we do? And one of the larger topics I think we're going to be wrestling with is actually the environment and how that impacts us. And we have to be sort of really, really responsible in that regard and on a collective level, because it impacts all of us. I think the coronavirus is a perfect example of what happens when things go awry.
Oh, I agree. I mean, that's been, well, they say it's been manufactured in a lab, don't they, as well? So it's like,
that is scary. Yeah, I know. That is really scary. I mean, that's getting into very science fiction world. I had not heard that, but that is kind of weird.
Yeah. I think I don't know if it's true, but it's highly possible. You know, I think that, you know, scientists mess with these viruses and things escape and get out. I'm not a conspiracy theorist, but if we keep, viruses are also evolving beings, I believe. So, and I read a whole article about that the other day. So viruses are adapting to what we humans do as well. So.
And they change the game. They are game changers in that regard. You know, there is a, you could even think of it as part of like natural selection in some ways. I mean, this could be a part of, you know, the planet cleansing itself in some way because we're overpopulated. I mean, I don't mean to be dire or morbid, but that could be an element of this. I mean,
I think it's a huge element of it, to be honest. And I don't do that from a point of fear. It's just like nature adjusting itself again.
It is. And I think that's its impact is, you know, I've been reading some articles this morning about the economic impact of this would be enormous. And I have been thinking about, you know, an economic collapse for quite some time now. A lot of us have been talking about it, especially over the next 3 to 4 or 5 years when Pluto gets to its direct station on the Pluto return for the U.S. and other countries. But it almost feels as if in the cyclical nature of history, that the United States has had its day in the sun, and now it's time to sort of pay the piper.
I think it is. Yeah, completely. The empire is collapsing.
Right, just the way the Roman Empire did and other empires, the British Empire have collapsed. And it's a necessary step, and that's why I refer to the term natural selection, because it's a way of sort of bringing us back to a spot where, you know, we can't be too full of hubris and reach too far and be too greedy. We've got to, this really brings us back to the core of, you know, helping each other as opposed to, that's why I like the collective sign of Aquarius for that, because it does really speak to the broader global tribe. We're all part of a tribe. We're not aliens. We are part of a tribe and we are all connected in that regard.
And I also think the discovery of all these dwarf planets and new astrological bodies is speeding this collapse up. We've got the 5 exact Pluto-Eris squares coming up over the next 2 years.
Yeah.
And Haumea, that's another one. And, you know, the universe is expanding as we realize all this connectedness that we've been talking about. And we realize that we cannot just control, which is what's been happening, the way the USA has been doing.
And it's sort of like, you know, as new planets are discovered, our evolution sort of is gets a preview of what we are supposed to be learning at that point. There's sort of like markers, you know, like we march through time and we discover Uranus. This is what Uranus does. And all of a sudden that becomes part of our conversation. And we discover Neptune. Oh, that becomes part of our conversation, and so on and so on. So these are all markers, and the universe is perpetually expanding. I think it has, since the first Big Bang, it's uh-huh. continued to expand, and that's this is sort of this pushing of the evolutionary process of our part to embrace new thoughts and methodologies, just as we do with our daily lives now.
And it's kind of exploding at the moment.
Yeah, it is. It's exploding. There's no question.
And it's happening. It kind of amuses me, and I've no wish to diss any other astrologer, but it does kind of amuse me that some astrologers are going back to the traditional methods and refusing to use some of the new energies. So.
Well, you know, that gets to my argument about the contemporaneous. You know, if we're going to be contemporary people living in a contemporary world, we need to have a contemporary language with contemporary tools. That's all part of the subject.
Exactly. But yet there's this polarity, again, to go to the polarities of this, no, I want to stay safe in the
right. Yeah, and it's limiting in some respects, and I'm not sure it does. I mean, I can understand the rationale, sort of like, well, this is how you bake bread, this is how you, you know, whatever, this is how you chop wood, carry water. And I understand those root sort of instinctual needs and desires that we all have. But by the same token, I think we need to be, we're dealing with different, whoever would have thought you could carry a thing around in your back pocket that held all of what they used to send, it has more than the information that they used to send a man to the moon and back. I mean, seriously, you know, I mean, just that alone.
I know, it is mind blowing, you know, and I tried to keep my book a little bit, not too out there, because I don't want to blow people's minds too much at a beginner level. I just want them to just look at things in a more expansive, diffuse way.
Right. You want to pique their interest so that they naturally are inclined to research it on their own and sort of push through the vernacular in a way that's meaningful in the long run, because it's really the most important way to learn. But
exactly.
And, you know, this is a sort of expansion quality that we're going through. You know, the idea of these new planets appearing really do introduce new levels of thought. And what does that bring to us? And how do we get there? And, you know, there's no coincidence that Pluto and plutonium were discovered at the same time. And they were, you know, they brought us to where we are today in a way that introduced the atomic bomb. And look what the destruction that wrought. I mean.
And Uranus brought the internet, really. So.
Exactly. It did. Certainly did, yeah. And look at the way that's changed our lives. I mean, there's things about it I hate. There's things about it that I can see where it's gone awry, and it's gone, you know, completely untethered. And I can also see the beauty of, here we are. I never would have known who you were had you not seen you on Facebook. So, I mean, it has wonderful things to it. It's a double-edged sword, like all things. It's a dualistic kind of tool.
Exactly. Yeah.
Really interesting stuff. You know, we're going through a very difficult time. I mean, we all are feeling, I mean, I say this to people, I think that I know that my readers have gone up and are more interested than they used to be. I've been doing this for a long time. I can see it on that very small little view that I have. And so I know that there's an interest there. People are really wondering what's going on, and they're turning to astrology for answers. And the answers are there. And I've had this discussion many times with several astrologers, and I always try to restate the fact that when we talk about astrology and we talk about politics, we can see distinct characters, we can see distinct trends, we can see all of those things are there. And when we speak, if we speak negatively about someone, we may not be speaking negatively with regard to political opinion, but negatively with regard to how we view them in the world of the panoply of the chart. It's part of the language that we're seeing. So in many ways, we're just simply being reporters as opposed to casting judgment. Don't you think that's fair to say?
Yeah, I would. And I also see, you know, the main characters in the game as almost like just playing their part.
Right. They're just playing their part, exactly. And we may not like the part that they're playing, but it mm-hmm. seems as if they're being very good actors, and they're adhering to their charter, their marching orders.
And I said when our current president was elected, and obviously I'm British by birth, the last election was my first federal election as an immigrant.
Oh, yeah, wow. You're lucky you got in beforehand.
but as an astrologer, I said that he's our shadow in our face.
Yes, so
he's exactly. Representing all what's been hiding behind the picket fence of the USA for many, many years, and it's now being revealed.
Actually, the greatest sin of the United States is racism, and he is the embodiment of it. So we have to resolve this, and I think the only way to really resolve it is to solve it. And, of course, that's not an easy thing to do, but that is inherent. And so this is true. He's a reflection of us. He's a symptom of what we are as a country. The division and the polarity is there. And unfortunately, it comes down to a numbers game. But I think also there's a purpose for him. I hate to say this, but I do believe this at my core. And the purpose for him is to sort of show this mirror, show us our face in the mirror. Here you are, guys. This is what you are like. Now, he may not see himself in that manner, but here we are. This is what you're like. Do you like what you see, or do you want to change it?
He also represents the American kind of obsession with fame and money and glitz.
And sex and money and all that stuff. The whole damn show. It's all there. It's very Las Vegas-like, for lack of a better word.
Exactly. So, you know, that's what the, not every American, of course, but as American, America as a whole has just gone for. It's what they've celebrated as.
It's what they've sold out for. Yes, that's what they celebrate. It's what we are. That's what advertising tells us to do. In some ways, we're being guided this way by Madison Avenue. In some ways,
right. You know, and Trump himself with all his gold in Trump Tower and all that is this obsession with money and achievement and wealth.
It's classic mythology just reborn into a new story. This is why I say this is the idea of the circle going around and around the corkscrew, because we've seen this character before. We've seen it in mythology. We've seen it in the great works of literature. We've seen these obsessive characters. And all of a sudden, now we have the real thing in our faces every night or every day or all day, every day.
we kind of got what we asked for, really.
Yeah, I think you're right. And I think it just took for us. But, you know, I have to say that I do think there's a redemptive quality to it. And I don't mean to be political here, but I think the redemptive quality is that had this not occurred, we would not have taken the steps to change. I think this is a defining moment of sorts, and it's a long stretch of a moment, whereby we hit the end of the pendulum, and the pendulum has to get pushed back in the other direction. And I think that's what will happen. But we have to go here first.
I completely agree. And it's why Bernie Sanders is rising on the other side.
Exactly.
And now in the lead in the polls.
Yeah. And that's sort of much. That's very much the opposite. And that, so we have these two competing views of which way we go. And, you know, traditional knowledge, traditional wisdom would say, listen, it's not about you or me. It's about us. The conversation has to be about us as a collective.
Yeah.
Not about me or you. We've been too me-centered. We've been too centered in that regard. We need to be more collective in our thought. And growing up, as I did in the time, I was a hippie in the 60s, I thought for sure we had arrived. And I thought that all the things that were happening back then, I lived in a commune, I did all this stuff, I thought for sure that we were well on our way to this sort of utopian world, and then it all came crashing down because we probably weren't ready for it. We didn't have the tools required that we have now that can make that more accessible and more likely to happen.
And then we had the 80s with greed is good.
Well, that we can thank Ronald Reagan for. I think that's a lot of that. And Margaret Thatcher, as you're coming from.
Exactly, Margaret Thatcher. Yeah.
And now we have, if looking at the parallels, you've got Boris Johnson and Donald Trump. Sort of a very similar character of sorts. And you know something? They're both Geminis, I believe. And they were both born in New York City. I think there's an age difference, I'm sure, but I think there's something fairly similar, and I'm not speaking of authority, so don't take my word on it.
No, they are both Gemini, and they were both born in New York City. Yeah.
Right, so there's something that's there. We can't deny that. They may not be the same, but they have a certain sort. I mean, the sort of the whole concept of Brexit and the tearing down of that structure is not that dissimilar from closing the borders. I mean, it's just like, it's me, me, me. And the me, me, me is not working really well. So,
interestingly, Bernie Sanders was born in New York as well, of course.
Brooklyn. Right. Yeah, he's from Brooklyn. Exactly. Yeah, exactly.
But he's a Virgo.
He's a Virgo. Yeah, much different character there. Although they got that mercurial trait to them.
Yes. Yeah, yeah. And, of course, he's square to the Gemini. So, mm-hmm.
yeah.
Yeah.
But you know, the power and the sort of the revolt, and I use the word revolt in quotes, the revolution is similar, because we're going through a revolution now of what our norms were. We're seeing unprecedented actions. We're seeing people act in ways we never saw before. The dignity of the office is gone. The fact that the American Medal of Freedom was given to this racist talk show host as opposed to somebody of higher quality is a perfect example of that. And we see a similar sort of experience happening overseas in this sort of circus phenomenon of things being different and pulling away from community. You know, I mean, the Brexit is I never understood Brexit, because it's this pulling away of the whole process of, you know, not being part of the EU, so we have our own, you know, sovereignty back again. But we need each other to survive. It sort of flies in the face of logic.
Absolutely. If I'd still had a vote, I would have voted to remain. But there you go. I don't have my vote there anymore. So.
Yeah, and did they ever open it up to a general referendum again, which is what they probably should have done that.
No, they didn't, because all the people have spoken. Anyway. I won't go into that because it's...
I know, it's a sore topic, it's a subject. But I think I guess the greater point I'm making, rather than drilling in under the finite pieces of it, is the overarching theme of the change underfoot. And I think that the change underfoot would not happen. We would not respond, perhaps, the way we are now in this upcoming election in the United States, which is drawing all kinds of people talking about it being the most important election of our history, of the history of our country. It could very well be. We're talking about a sea change here. And which way does that sea change go? We are desperate for the sea change because the old way is not working. So we've got to make a choice.
And yet we do still have the center kind of trying to hold on to that mythic, you know, and again, this is not against him politically, necessarily, Biden. He's like, we've got to return to how it was. And that's the Saturn in Capricorn going, let's hold on.
That's just not realistic. You know, it's just like saying, I want to go back to yesterday. You can't go back to yesterday. You can't go back to a minute ago. No, you can't. You can see it on film, but you can't go back to that time. The whole concept of going back, just that alone, make America great again. You can't go back. I mean, anybody with any logic, that's the whole basis of astrology, is this constant moving forward.
Exactly.
You know, we're never going to go back there. Well, we're not going to solve the problem today, but at least it's worthwhile to bring it up and talk about it in terms of, with astrological terms, because I think that the astrology is a mirror of where we are now.
Yeah, it is completely. And it does give you kind of a bigger picture overview.
It's overdue as well, so that's a good point.
Well, it is. But, you know, obviously I do not like Trump. I did not vote for him. I did not celebrate his win. I am not on that side. But it did enable me to kind of step back when he won and go, oh, well, I guess, you know, we needed this to get to the next bit. So.
That's what I think. Otherwise, we would become too complacent. We'd become too pliable. We'd be on the sofa eating, watching TV all day. We wouldn't get this. This forces us into action. It forces us into action, which I think is very constructive and useful.
And it stops you spiraling into a big despair.
Yeah, I know. It's really. It does explain an awful lot about what's happening. Whether you believe in astrology or not, it does explain a lot of what's happening. And I think there's probably more people out there that are watching the astrology of this than want to admit. I think that's probably pretty true, because people don't always like to admit about the whole idea of astrology, because they think it's sort of, well, it's got that sort of Hollywood, you know, thing to it that makes it seem a little bit out there. But the truth really is there. It's incredible how much it's there.
Back to that kind of glitz thing again.
Yeah.
But astrology goes as deep as you want it to, I think.
Right, and it's limitless, I think, in that regard, because the language is there and it depends upon... And the great cycles are there. This is what I like. I mean, the outer planets really do speak to this generational kinds of sea changes and this sort of this... the process of this birth and death and renewal and this whole process has to continue. And we talk about Pluto as being the great deconstructor and then reconstructor. And I do believe that when we get through all this, we will come out of this emerged as a greater entity with a much different set of values and ideas. I think that'll be the case. I think that's the only way to really process this. I always thought that when I was a kid that the only way we would ever achieve peace in the world, on our planet, and this is kind of an unusual way of looking at it, was that if we had a common enemy or a common threat, and because that would bring us all together. You know, we wouldn't have to have borders if we were all trying to, you know, keep the planet from burning up or going off course. We would all pull together. So that would be a unifying factor, which would allow us to become the tribe we're supposed to be. So that's, you know, that's this tearing down is a useful probably process. And we could probably see it mirrored in some natural fact somewhere with a planet or a turtle or something, where they, the way they live their lives is probably all spelled out there.
Well, that kind of brings me back to my whole theory about the Age of Aquarius being the mix of the ancient and modern. Indigenous ways are really being brought back in and listened to again in this world, and that's very shamanic as well. For example, in Australia with the fires, they're finally learning from the Aborigines how they managed fire back in the ancient days. And yes, I think you're right. The common enemy is probably going to be climate change. And we have to listen to the old ways, which were more in alignment with the natural cycles of the planet and the cosmos.
Yeah, so. We can't ignore that. We're not above the planet. We still are going to be humans. We're still going to be victims of nature, because you can't stop a forest fire or an earthquake or a tornado or a hurricane or anything else.
But we can learn to listen to nature and listen to the natural cycles, which is what astrology does as well as the indigenous ways, and bring it into the future.
Yeah. Is that how you work with, I mean, the shamanic approach that you take really is rooted in that very deep centered earth piece, right? It really is coming from the core.
It is very, very, very much coming from the earth as our core. The earth is our Pachamama, if you like.
Right.
And but also, you know, learning the cycles of the moon and everything, how that affects the earth. And so it is really about living in complete alignment. And we as a modern society, and I include myself in that, you know, I live in a box. You know?
Yeah. We all got a box. We all got a phone. So we're no different.
But we have to bring more of the alignment back in. I've been trying to encourage my clients for months and years even now, to start growing some of their own food at least again.
Mm-hmm. Very good idea, yeah.
And maybe coming back into community to help with a little community garden or something.
That's one of the downsides of the internet world, though, that bothers me, because it does push us into isolation in some regard. We communicate through the vehicle of this filter of the Facebook or whatever vehicle you want to call it. But it does... Because more people are working at home than they ever did before. They're more isolated. People are shut behind their door, and their window outside is through, the social media platforms. Whereas, I'm not saying people don't go out to the bars and have get together with family dinners and all that, but as a general rule, we are more removed from that. We don't have the main street here like you do in we haven't got the small villages where people get out in the morning and go to the stores and say hello everybody on the street, or the you know, we don't have that same sort of mold here. Our closest thing we have is the malls, and the malls are closing in the United States. I mean, they're going under, so we don't have that main street connection.
I always try and look for where it's happening, though, and I can only speak to Salt Lake City where I live, and there is a big permaculture movement.
That's
and
good.
Groups of people coming together to create community permaculture gardens, and so it is starting to happen underneath it all, and they use the internet to draw other people in. So.
Right, this is where it really works. Yeah, I mean, it's a double-edged sword. You're right. It has its disadvantages, but it also has great reach, because you can reach a lot of people that way, and you can get your message out there. And that does build community. It's just more of a virtual community as opposed to hands on the ground. But there's benefit to both of them. So
the internet is a blessing and a curse. But I really do see people starting to get more local again. You get the shop local days more and things like that. People are becoming more aware of it. Mm-hmm. So.
Well, it disturbs me, though, is to see in my town in particular, I've seen a lot of small businesses go under and just close their doors. Businesses that have been there for 30, 40 years are no longer there. Now, granted, you're going to get some of that happening anyway as people come and go and fathers sell their businesses and push them out, but it's not the same. So there's a, you know, there's sort of this even retail is probably the best example of all, because now everything is delivered to your door in a truck instead of going out to this down the street to try the pair of shoes on or put the dress on or put the shirt on. Now it gets delivered to you, and if you don't like it, you send it back. You know, it's a huge exorbitant waste of time and money, but that's the way we live these days, and that's it what is. I bemoan sort of that intermittent, you know, I'd like to see that return.
I would too, but and I think it will, because I think people are starting to get it, you know.
And we sort of had our fun with it, and we're ready to go back to being normal again.
And the malls are closing, because they're just, you go to any mall and it's just the same stores.
It's a cookie cutter. It really is. That's not that very good. It's not exciting at all.
People getting bored with it, I think.
Well, you know, I've traveled around the country a lot, and I traveled a lot when I was younger and also recently. And what bothers me is that you go to the small towns and you don't, or even bigger, even fairly good sized towns, you know, towns of 200,000 people or whatever, you don't see any regional color so much as you do see all the chain stores, like you mentioned. You see everything the same. So you could go someplace in Massachusetts and then go down to Alabama and see the exact same array of stores. You really got to go out of your way to find the locals.
You really do.
And that's
I'm eternal optimist, though, being a Sagittarius with a
I am too. I'm an optimist.
Major Sagittarius stellium, and I do see glimmers of it changing.
Yeah, I do too. And I think we got to be optimistic. Just, you know, history is a slow process, and it may not happen in our lifetime, but at least we can be optimistic that it's on its way.
Yeah.
Anyway, we've had a great chat today. My guest today has been Louise Edington. Her website is louiseedington.com, louiseedington.com. And it's a funny site. It's a great site because it's astrology for kick-ass women, and that's what we are, and that's what you are. And it's great to have that little thing there. And she's just completed a book called The Complete Guide to Astrology, which you can get at your local bookstore. Speaking of community, help the local guy out. Or you can default to that other guy who delivers it to you in a Piper box on the back step. So whatever you want to do. At least it's there.
I believe it is in some indie bookstores.
Yeah, there you go. Especially.
The Noble.
Especially the books. So thank you so much, Louise, for coming on today. Great to talk to you.
Thank you very much for having me, Chris. Yeah. It's been meeting you.
Thanks. You've been listening to Turning of the Wheel with your host, Chris Flisher. To schedule a reading with me or to order artwork, you may visit my website at www.turningofthewheel.com. That's www.turningofthewheel.com. Or you can call me at 978-393-1036. Thank you. And as always, be open to possibilities.